Shall we start, madam?
Yes.
Yes. So, pleasant good morning to all. So, on behalf of Sri Venkateshwara College of Engineering and on behalf of all the participants present here, so I am very much happy to welcome Dr. P. Mallika from NITTR Chennai. So, who is going to deliver sessions on e-content development for higher education and also open educational resources today. So I'm very much happy to welcome Dr. P. Mallika for this particular faculty development training program sponsored by Anna University. And so I'm taking the privilege of introducing Dr. P. Mallika to the participants present here. So at present, she is the associate professor in the Department of Computer Science and Engineering from NITTR Chennai. And she's also heading the Center for Educational Media and Technology in NITTR Chennai. Dr. P. Mallika has around 30 years of experience in teaching, training, and research. Regarding her educational background, she has completed her B.S. Computer Science and Engineering from University of Madras, then M.S. Software Systems from BITS Pilani, and also M.S. by Research from Anna University. And also she has completed a PhD from University of Madras. So the major contributions of Dr. P. Mallika are, so she has been a resource person for more than 350 short-term courses in computer science related areas. And Dr. P. Mallika has coordinated 250 short-term programs in computer science areas. She also served as a resource person for long-term programs, namely PGD DCA, BTech Education, MTech HRD, and overseas teachers. Dr. P. Mallika has coordinated 6 international programs for overseas teacher on educational media production for e-learning and instructional design for e-learning. She has trained 140 Bangladesh teachers and administrators in ICT and web designing. And she has presented about 26 research papers, and she has published in various areas of computer science and education in national and international conferences and also in international journals. And she was also a team member in development of 10 CBTs by Computer Center NITTR. She has produced several educational video programs in computer science and engineering. She has guided students and teachers for various project works, and also she is acting as doctoral committee members and also examiner for Anna University and University of Madras. Dr. P. Mallika, to her credit, she has offered 2 SWAYAM MOOC courses on e-content development, OER for empowering teachers, and coordinated AICTE NITTT Module 1. She has also served as coordinator for SWAYAM MOOC for teacher training courses, NITTR Chennai, sponsored by MHRD, Government of India. So her research areas of interest are data mining, cloud computing, technology-enabled learning and teaching, instructional design, e-learning, and OER immersive technologies. So we have an eminent speaker today with us, Dr. P. Mallika. So I'm very much happy to welcome Dr. P. Mallika in this occasion. Now I'm handing over the session to Dr. P. Mallika.
Very good morning to all. Thank you very much, Madam Professor Kumuda, for introducing me with so generous words. First of all, I would like to have a word, because I have a long association with the Sri Venkateshwara College of Engineering. When I was, that is after completion of my 12th standard, I was allocated CIT, Coimbatore College. But at that time, during that time, my parents said, okay, you have to be in Chennai itself. So for my first thing, I just went to the door and got it to SVCE. On that day, for first year, we were not admitted because no ladies for the first batch. SVC didn't have ladies, so again we had another college. So second thing, my son completed his BE Electronics and Communication in SVCE. So I have a lot of gratitude to that, and I have visited SVCE in different occasion as a parent, as a guest lecturer, and I have delivered few lectures in computer science and engineering where. Previously, I do not know whether Susan is there. She was the heading the department. So with this few words, that is immediately when Venkateshwara College of Engineering came, my memories I just wanted to share. Thanks for listening for that. Let me start my presentation, right? I will share my screen. Okay. Okay, hope you are able to see my screen.
Yes, ma'am. Yes.
Yes. Okay, so let me present and we'll have some questions at the end for us to discuss. So the topic given to me was on e-content development, and I would like to say this is the need of the hour, because you know that for the past 1.5 years or more than 1 year, we are all doing only online teaching, right? And the students are learning through online. So during, even not only during this pandemic situation, even after this pandemic situation, there is a lot of requirement where we have to develop the e-content. And it is not new only, which has been happening during this pandemic. Like if you look into the Ministry of Education now, like from 2004 onwards, through NMEICT, that is National Mission on Education through Information Communication Technology, it was creating a lot of e-content, starting from NPTEL, then you have FOSI, then spoken tutorials, then what virtual labs, vlabs.co.in, and so many initiatives. Now we have the Swayam MOOC, Swayam Prabha, Yantra, many things, and they have also started the National Repository for Open Educational Resources. So we have, as a nationwide, we have started doing collecting lot of contents. Okay, so creating content for teaching, learning, and research purpose. And only thing is whether we are using it, whether we are aware of it, whether we are using it in our teaching learning process. That is very, very essential, right? So we will discuss why the learner characteristics, okay, first, and then the interactive and innovative teaching method, then managing the technology, managing the learning material, managing the students, and packaging the content and delivery. One second. I'll just switch on my fan. Okay. Yeah, first thing is we will see we are addressing our present generation. If you see the present generation, it is different from our generation, how we whatever it is. Okay, so what is it, right? If you look into the availability of materials, availability of the learning resources, it is totally different. Previously, we had whatever information or instruction, it was through the gurus or teachers, and we had the textbooks and gurus. But now if you look into our students, the present day generation learners, anyone, so the information is ubiquitous. It is available everywhere, isn't it? So that is a difference. Fine. And then actually, when you talk about their characteristics, they are multimodal learners. What do you mean by multimodal learners are? See, they learn from variety of sources, isn't it? Like videos, podcasts, then textbooks, reference material, journal, articles, through the teacher, through their friends. So there are different ways from different things. They learn it. They learn through images, graphics, which gives stimulus to various senses. So we have to understand that our present day learners are multimodal learners. And of course, they are very good at discovering information. When I say, information is ubiquitous, it is available everywhere. That is not the thing, right? So what the teacher does in the class is instruct, right? They facilitate learning. So with this information, how to construct the knowledge and skill? That is very important. See, now information everywhere it is available. With that information, what we are going to do? So our students are good at discovering information. So again, the same information, we should not tell it in the class, right? And then they have shorter attention span. How short it is? It is in the research says that in higher education, it is around 7 to 10 minutes. Say, let us say 10 minutes, okay? Maximum we will take, like optimum or around 10 minutes, that is in the lower classes. So fine. So let us say in higher education, it is around 10 minutes, less than 10 minutes or around 10 minutes. So when in a class, how do you handle the sessions? How do you prepare the content? If you prepare a content for 1 hour video, people will not be able to continuously listen to it. So even if it is in a video or even if it is a class or whatever material it is, there should be little bit of breaks. Like, let us say, for example, you are going for a film. So that too, particularly in our Indian films, it is, you have so many things bundled together, isn't it? So you have 4 or 5 songs, the action, comedy, then a storyline, everything is big. So for why so much different varieties has been given? To make the audience sit and listen, see that or enjoy that one. Same way, our students should have lot of activities. So we cannot give the other things. So what we can do as a teacher, we can learn from that analogy that we have to give lot of activities in between our things. Maybe in your class, maybe even in the videos, now you can create inline quizzes, or even if it is a text material also, the points to capture. So the writing a text also, it is very, very essential. So how will you put it? Okay, the framework you have to do. You talk about something, you reinforce something, and then you have to elicit performance. That is how much they have understood. So like that, we have to plan, right? So why it is like that? Because they have very shorter attention span. Flexible learning environment. Of course, the present generation, where we call them as a Generation Z, isn't it? So I would like to share this. The people who are born between 1940s and 1960s are called the baby boomers. And from 1960s to 1980s are called the digital migrants. I'm a digital migrant. Okay. And then people born after 1980s to 2000, you have Generation X, Y, Z or millennials learners. And then now the people who are born after 2000 to 2015, they are called the Generation Z. And see, and this generation has a lot of changes in that, okay? And the present day generation, they love to have a very flexible learning environment, very relaxed learning environment. In online, it is totally relaxed, right? And they like to have informal simulating environment. They don't want to be very rigid, formal, like that, authoritative. They want to have a very, their preferences. Okay, I'm just telling about their preferences. They want to have a very informal, but it should be simulating, okay, simulating to their things. And then definitely you have to note down that they prefer active learning. They don't want to be a passive learners. Okay, they prefer interaction and collaboration. And they are experiential learners. When I say experiential learners means they want to experience, and then through that experience they want to learn. Okay, they are very, very comfortable with the technology. They are multitasking and they learn a lot from the peers also, peer learning. And the most important, that is, they are extremely relational. That is, they require the motivation, appreciation, all those from the teachers. Otherwise, no, like the students whom you are handling are all the late adolescent students where their hormonal their imbalance will be there, and they are very, very sensitive for emotions. Okay, the emotional, they are very sensitive. And even let us say, for example, if somebody scolds, or if some bullying or love failure, something, even small things also, they take it to heart, and then immediately they go to an extreme where they go for suicide, right? So here, that is, I'm telling the other the extreme cases, but here, like, it will gradually, as you mature, that will never happen. In our age, if somebody or HOD or your principal scolds us or gives our remarks, you know what action you will have it, right? You don't go for that extreme. But because at that age, it is like that, right? And then lot of motivation, no? Like when the students like the subject because of the teacher. The teacher could have given some hint or some motivation or some light, thrown some light on some particular, that motivates or kindles his interest, and he excels in that particular field. Even, let us say, you're all civil engineer professors working, right? Okay, in that you have so many things, water management, structural analysis, like very, so I'm not very, like, I know a few things like hydraulics, like you have so many different environmental engineering, in that construction management, so many divisions. So they go in for a particular thing because they like the teacher or some motivation the teacher could have given, something like that, right? So these are the learner characteristics. I think you could have understood what is multimodal learning, like, which gives stimulus to various senses, like visual, auditory, reading and writing, and kinesthetic. Okay, so because you have to understand there are different types of learners in our classes. Okay, and they have their learning styles. So everyone is unique. Even as a teacher also, no two teacher teaches the same subject in the same way, isn't it? The same way, the students also, everyone can learn. See, coming to your higher education, everyone can learn. There will be some delta X change. There should be some delta X change or in their learning thing, fine? So in that case, how can we facilitate the learning? How can you facilitate the learning? So given the time, given the resources, given the environment, everyone can learn, but that differs. Maybe I'm a slow learner. I take 2 days to get the concept and learn. Maybe somebody will be, you will be very fast learner. You can do it in a class or in a half an hour thing. So everyone can learn given the time, given the resources, given the environment to learn. So how can we facilitate as a teacher? See, we are all taking nowadays online classes. That will not be sufficient for them, no? So there will be so many issues and challenges in the online classes. For example, our students will say, madam, bandwidth problem, or your voice is breaking, mic power is gone. So many things, the data, only 1 GB per day it is gone. All those things they will say whenever we take some classes. Okay, a few things. But what? How do you facilitate? So not only this online synchronous mode, it has to be done with asynchronous mode. What I say is asynchronous mode is you have to supplement your teaching. So you're connecting with the students for 3 hours per week. Let us say 3 hours per week for a subject, or 4 hours according to the credit, 4 hours of 3 hours per week subject. That alone is that is the direct contact where you can discuss about the doubts, or you can question them, or they can question, or you can give them a task so that they can do small things during the class. But again, you can take them to higher level thinking skills, provided if you provide the e-content in some platform where they can learn and come to your class. So that is very much essential. So knowledge construction, that is information acquisition, is added to the learner's memory and integrates multiple representation to improve the learning outcome. See, why multimodal means, let us say, if you have a visual tendency, no? Like, let us say, you can, as a professor, you can remember the faces of your students rather than their names. Even after he comes after 20 years, where he could have had a big beard or even fallen hair, you will be able to recognize them. No, okay, he's my student, and you will have some association. Few student names you might remember. Okay, and you can associate, and you can okay, he's. But names we don't, because that visual pattern has been. Like the humans can remember more, right? So the so if you give apart from your they are learning from your teaching, that is by hearing or listening, actually listening, they can all, if you provide some other content like videos or text materials or some activities, that will be very, very efficient for them to construct a knowledge and for their memory retention, and then transfer that knowledge in a, they can apply the knowledge and skill in the new situation, okay, or in a different situation. So then the learners are also becoming engaged when you give a different type of modes, okay. And then see, one size, that is what I was saying, everybody is unique, one size will not fit everybody. But usually in a class we give generalized instruction. But we are suppose, like let us say with the technology, we can have personalized learning. They can, you can provide or facilitate the personalized learning with that, right? So reasons, okay, these are the reasons. So still we are following our traditional methods, but it has to be, like we know that now there is a big paradigm shift from the teacher-centered learning to the student-centered learning, starting from the curriculum, starting from the then going to the teaching learning process, maybe only the assessment, it has to, a lot of things has to be worked out. So here, so now the teacher has a different role, no? The teacher is not the sage on the stage, not even guide by the side. We are co-constructor of learning in higher education. So we are called as resource person, facilitator, guide by the side, or the finally we are they are also learning, we are also learning, co-constructor of learning, okay. So that is the role of the teacher in the present situation. So here as a teacher, we have to have this knowledge framework, just to share with you. So you have, definitely you're all civil and allied branch professors are attending. So the content, that is a must for any teacher, like whatever you might be teaching, you might be a school teacher or a college teacher or whatever it is. So whatever we do with the content mastery should be there, content knowledge, no doubt about it, okay. The for a teacher, the content knowledge alone is not sufficient, okay. That alone is not sufficient. It has to be, this content knowledge is alone not sufficient. You should have the pedagogical knowledge. This is what to teach and this is how to teach. See, the you might be a big, let us say, a very good researcher, or you could have produced so many journal papers, or you are carrying so many research, but whether you know how to put it, that is very, very important, the pedagogical knowledge, how to deliver, right? So maybe that person may fit for the research things, okay? Definitely a teacher has to do research as well as now we are doing many things, no? Like teaching, research and administration, we have to do it. But in the early stages, the teacher should know how to teach it by practice, by learning the nuances of it, you will be knowing it. So what to teach, how to teach, and this. During this pandemic, everybody were embracing this technology and we were using this technological knowledge. So you should know how to use the technology, for example, how to use the video conferencing tools or the virtual classroom tools like Google Meet, Zoom, Cisco WebEx, there are many. Okay, and then not only that is for the synchronous mode. Then for the asynchronous mode, then engaging tools, excuse me. So these three things are very, very important for a teacher, okay? So technological, pedagogical, content knowledge. So it is not going to stop, right? Hope this corona wave, everything should stop. We should not go for 3, 4, 5, something like that. The news is very alarming. But let us say, even after this corona, we should not go back to our face-to-face only. It should be a blend of face-to-face and technology. Okay, so where you can push face-to-face, where they can practice the skill, come to the college, talk. See, that social presence is very, very important for the human, though, the learning environment, that should be there. But the content, the e-content and the learning things can be pushed on to the asynchronous mode, which should be available for the students to access, because accessibility should be there. So we, in order to, these are the different interactive teaching tools like flipped learning, blended learning, collaborative session, gamification. I want to emphasize on usage of LMS. Okay, so during this pandemic, people were embracing this online teaching. That some and many people they have not gone into the learning management system. So it is now going to become a mandatory, either your institute or your department or as an individual. Okay, if the department or the institute is not providing this LMS, then as an individual, at least, to start with, you should have this learning management system where you are going to share the resources and the activities. These are called the e-content, okay, for the teaching learning purpose. So where you are going to share these resources onto the platform, and it is between you and your students, okay? Why learning management system? You can also say, okay, madam, I am just sharing it in our WhatsApp or in our website. That alone is not sufficient, because you should know your customer. You should know your students, how much they have learned, how far they have learned, how much time they have spent, right? During your assessment, a formative assessment, how well they are doing, where is my class, what is my class average, which question or which part of the thing they are finding it difficult, where they are getting low. So these analytics will help the teacher to make to look into this your learning person, okay? So where you can give a personalized learning environment. So other things you might be knowing, okay, like all these are the other interactive learning. Okay, this is what I said in the beginning. The attention span will be at some top, and after sometimes after the time increases or it goes, then the attention span decreases. But it varies. It should vary at least, right? It should not drastically go to the end to zero. Fine, the attention span. So you have to make it to that green level ideal. How? You can give lot of activities in between the classes. So the ideal situation has to be reached by bringing lot of activities in the classes through different content. So what is the implication to the teacher is long lectures are not recommended. Teaching with technology will have a greater impact. Mix up the methods, use flow charts, concept chart, different things, video clips, maps, clickers, presentation, and other tools. And you can also explore the micro learning. Micro learning is just a just-in-time learning or a small learning objects, where you can create. No, now it is very easy for everyone to create the e-content. Previously, you should have the professional equipments or professional knowledge to create all those things. Now it is everyone can do it. Like the teacher can create her own thing, and they can share it with their students. Okay, so small creating object. You can talk for 1 minute or 2 minutes, then just post it in the WhatsApp to your students. Or it can be a small video or anything. It can be even a material also. So that will help them to learn a lot. And then definitely learning management system. So there are different modes, okay? So collaboration, discussion, feedback and reflection, guided, explicit, that is learning from the expert, demonstration, experiential, making, explore and investigate. And other one is they learn by self. So there are different learnings. And if you look into the national education policy also, they are encouraging multidisciplinary holistic thing. And if you see the 21st century skills, what are the 21st century skills? That is learning and innovation skills. If you look into it, see, one is the communication, collaboration, critical thinking, and creativity. Okay, so are we in our classes, are we able to inculcate these four C's, I can say, these four C's in our teaching learning process? So that is very important, because you cannot have a separate session for communication or separate session for collaboration. Even in our the teaching and learning, see, the outcomes, you know, the course outcomes has been given in three in all the things, like in cognitive, psychomotor and affective domain. So where it will have all the things, what is the knowledge required, what is the skill required, everything it has to take care. And are you, so we have to think, am I fulfilling the course outcomes? Okay, so for that course outcomes, you might require different types of content which will help or facilitate the students to develop it. Apart from that, the 21st century skills, whether we are able to inculcate it. Okay, so yes, we have to use this information communication technology. So every teacher has to know how to capture, how to interpret, how to store and transmitting information. I hope everyone we are doing it, but how effectively we are using in our teaching learning process, that is very, very essential. So as a teacher, you should know to manage the five different types of technology. One is the learning management system, I would like to ask, what type of learning management system do you use? Okay, do you use? You can put it in the chat, otherwise it will be. So what type of learning management system do you use it? Maybe in the chat. Good morning. Yes, can you type it? Or you can unmute and talk. You can say Google Classroom. Okay. Kannadasan is saying Google Classroom. Then? So, sir, Kannadasan, sir, do you belong to which college you're belonging to? Same institute, SVC, Edmodo. Oh, great. G Classroom. Okay. Many people are using Google Classroom. Fine. Zoom, Muthuraja, Zoom you are using. Zoom, that is for the synchronous mode, isn't it? That is for the synchronous classes. Zoom is not a full-fledged LMS, right? It is not an LMS. It is a video conferencing tool. Of course, it supports many activities. See, in the past 1 year, you can see that the Google Meet or any other software, they have evolved. And a lot of things it is supporting. For example, if you look into the Google Meet itself, now you have activities where you can post activities on the end, if you see that, no? So let us say, here you have whiteboard activities. Sometimes if you have the G Suite for the institution, then you can have different types of activities. For, let us say, Jamboard or whiteboard, then that is the collaborative tools. And then you have polling, right? So Google Classroom. Okay, so it is very, very essential that you have to use an LMS. You can have Canvas, you can have Moodle, you can have Edmodo, anyone, everything is not. So like you have varieties, you can use any one of it, but it should, any one LMS is a must, is a mandatory for you. Because even you can create, whenever you can store all your assessment details, you can store all your resources, activities, what you are going to share it with the thing. And when you are doing for one semester, meticulously, if you plan for one semester, the next semester you can make a copy of it, and only the students will change, and you will not be recreating it. You need not start from the scratch. So it will be a very, very helpful tool in a long run. Okay. So first, initially, you have to start. You are doing it, but you have to upload it in the LMS. Like it can be Google Classroom, or it can be Edmodo, or it can be Moodle, or it can be Canvas. So there are a lot of tools, educational technology tools available that every teacher has to know apart from their content knowledge. Excuse me. I'll go back to my presentation. Fine. So this is where I left it. What it is. So you have, as a teacher, we have to have at least three different types of technology. Of course, you will be using so many tools in your civil engineering applications, for structural engineering, for water resource management, for construction management, for project management. And so everything you'll have a lot for design, like for every part you are having so many computer applications, that is different. That is for your discipline. That comes under your content knowledge. Apart from that, as a teacher, this is general, okay, whether you are a civil engineer or a mechanical engineer or a computer science engineer, like you should know how to use these things, right? So that is, one is the LMS, another one is the video conferencing software. That is what our Google Meet, Zoom, Cisco WebEx, GoToWebinar, anyone, whichever your institute is providing, you can go for it. And then another thing is learner management software. Learner's management software is like that. See, in a class, to engage a student is more difficult. Right? It is very challenging. Even in our physical class itself, it is very challenging, but still we know that he is physically present there. Okay. We can find out whether he is mentally or absent, okay? But here in our online classes, that is too more difficult. We do not know. So we are asking our students to switch off their, audio, video, to in order to have very good bandwidth or with less disturbance. We wanted to have our sessions. So in that cases, we do not know whether he's sitting there or just logged in, given his attendance or whatever it is, and he's doing some other job. It's very difficult, no? So in that cases, we should know how to engage the students. So there are softwares like Mentimeter, okay, Quizzes, Kahoot, Poll Everywhere. Polling, all these are very simple software which you can use it inside the class itself. After every 3 minutes or 2 minutes, not sorry, it's a 2 minutes or 3 minutes activity, you can use it after every 10 minutes or 15 minutes like that. So that is that you have to know. And then assessment tools. So every teacher should know to use the assessment tools, starting from simple Google Forms, where you can create quizzes or even to create a highly complex proctored exam. Now everybody started writing their online exams, before the web camera. Now it is a open book exam. So different technology we are using. We are using the AI and other things, right? So fine. So you should know these different assessment tools. And of course, in engineering, we should know to use the virtual labs available. Okay, virtual labs, because ours, like the skill part, they should come to the lab and practice the resource. Civil engineering, mechanical engineering, you need a lot of equipments that cannot be done at from their place. Okay, so how can they do it? So for if it is on the simulation part, or if they are using this design level, that is okay. They can do it. So they can use this virtual labs, and then they can have all those things. Like many simulation virtual labs are available. Make use of it. And when the time comes, when everything is normal, they come, they practice it. Okay. So that is how we can manage the situation. Right. This is what. So then managing the student, yes, attention span, the course content, that is where you have to cater to their different needs, requirements, and motivation also should be there. right? The student motivation, that you have to motivate them. See, usually we do it in our classes, no? So let us say, if you finish this, or let us listen, this is going to be very important. You will have a question on it in the formative or in the end exam, like that. From simple motivation to different types of motivation, you do it, right? Fine. So this is called the community of inquiry model, where the cognitive presence is the content, the knowledge, okay, the content giving the learning environment, okay, that is the cognitive presence. The teacher presence is very, very essential, where they'll setting the climate, selecting the content, okay, and the social presence, that is what missing here, right? The social presence. So they want to have that environment where they look into their peers and learn. So these three things, that is the cognitive presence, the knowledge part, the social presence, and the teacher presence is required in order to have a very good educational experiences, okay? All right. So this is what I was telling. You can give different types of activities, from very short activity to a let us say, for example, different types of activities, right? Very short, or like it can be a poll, or it can be a think pair share, a minute paper, summarizing or fill in the blanks, or you can have a breakout session. See, even in Google, you have Zoom, you have breakout rooms where you can create small groups and give them work, let them discuss among themselves and come back. Like that you can try, right? So which we do it in our classes, even in online, it can be done. Verbal quizzes, problem solving, creating questions, and collaborative works, because that is required, which you can tell them to do outside the class, okay? Complete them outside the class. So when you say this e-content means which has different things like text, image, graphics, animation, audio, video, everything. It can be a single, or it can be combination of all these things put together, where you can display online or offline, okay? So that is called the e-content. So this is very, very, so different pictures, okay? So e-content, you can have these things: audio, video, simulation, animation, interactives, e-books, immersive content. Now this is the latest thing, okay? Immersive technology. So we have a very beautiful lab set up in NITTGR. We are also offering this e-learning technology, ME, that is postgraduate courses from this year onwards, where they can create this augmented reality, virtual reality courses. So many applications are in for the civil and architectural. See, the pipelines, all those things, no? Like if you are going to build a big, models or buildings, so how it goes? So people from different places, through the software, they interact, and not only interact, they also see, okay, what's happening, how the designing parts, all those things, no? So they get, that is called the immersive technology. Or simply I can put augmented reality is, see, let us say, very simple example, which many people, even for the school children, are using, is the AR books, augmented reality books, AR books. See, if you see, in those days when we used to buy picture books for our kids, no, when they are in the kindergarten and other things, right? LKG, UKG, so many picture books we used to buy. Now the same book is coming as an AR book. So when the now everybody is, even a small kid, no, they take up this phone. So when you place the phone, this was what is it, the tab or this phone on the book, immediately you can see a lion or an elephant or through that, okay? So that feel, no, where you can do it. And even for the storytelling, you have an immersive technology. Space, if they are going to learn about the space, there will be a software where they'll put the headset, and as if they are traveling in the space, that type of softwares has been created. So it can be also used in the engineering part, like let us say the nuclear plant or some places where you cannot really mining, where you can you cannot give the training. They use this virtual reality thing, and then that is the very advanced level, right? So that is called the immersive technology or immersive content, where we can have the augmented reality or virtual reality.
Excuse me, ma'am. Whether you're presenting or your presentation is not visible.
Oh, so long. Yeah? When it was there, when, okay, sorry. You could have told me. I didn't see it. Just on talking. Okay, so I think from this onwards, you know, I'll just start it. Yeah, this is what we were discussing, the five technologies. Okay, just a recap, because sorry for that, I'm just doing a recap because many people could have left that for the learning management system. Then we should have the knowledge about the video conferencing. Then this is what I'm talking about, the learner engagement software, like small software which you can use in between the classes, like polling, then Mentimeter, many things. I will try give a demonstration also. Then the assessment tool which I was telling, from simple tools like Google Forms to the complex proctored exam, then the virtual labs. Okay, this five technology the teacher has to do. This is about regarding the passion. So we were talking about all these things, right? Then the e-content. So now I was talking, I'm telling about the different e-content types, okay? Audio, video, simulation, animation, interactives, then immersive technology, that is called the AR and VR. Then we call it as AR books are called the energized book, presentation, database, e-journals, games, rich internet applications, visuals, data. So all this or any form or all forms are called as e-content. So you know, you see, these e-content may be available, okay, where you can, if it is a very complex professional things, you can also purchase, but I don't recommend for that. We are right. So other thing is, we can use the freely available. See, if your institute budget allows, and if there is a need, then you can go for purchase of material. See, a school is there, but we sometimes go for this Baiju and other. I'm just giving an example, because no, that is having a cost on it, right? Additional cost for the parents to do it. So why can't we ourselves do it in a class? So sometimes we cannot do it because maybe to that level we don't have the expertise, or we don't have the time or resources, we'll not be able to do it. So I'm not going to talk about it in higher education. I'm not going to talk about it. We are using our own material, right? And lot of freely available content is available where you need not start from the scratch. So that is what I'm going to discuss in the second session, okay? So that is freely available content, which is very, very useful. A lot of things are available. I am going to show you different content, materials, which you can use it in your teaching learning process, in your discipline, right? And you can produce your materials on your own. Or let us say a lot of materials can be produced and it is available, and everybody can use it. See, like Government of India, like if you look into it, Sakshat is available, where you can go and use it, because you have all the rights to use all those materials in your teaching learning process. So that is how you can create it. So for that you need a lot of things. See, if you want to have if you want to produce your own material, or if you want to fine tune or modify the existing material, some of the tools are required. Okay, There are different types of softwares. Some are proprietary, some are open source. So when I say proprietary, see, there are four things I wanted to be very clear. There are four types. One is proprietary. Proprietary means it is closed or it is not open, and it comes with a cost. You have to buy, right? That is one. Like let us say Windows OS or Microsoft Office, anything like that. That is a proprietary system. It has been owned by a company. Then you have to buy it and use it. Let us say, for example, open source software. If you say open source software, it is open. It is by the community developers. It may or may not be free. Mostly it is free. Okay. Like let us say Blender, Inkscape, in your GIS and other construction, there are a lot of open source software also, okay, open GIS, something like that in your discipline. I'm just telling about the general things, right? So that is open software means it comes with a source code where you can modify it, where you have the freedom to modify the code or customize according to your requirement, okay? Another one is a freeware. Freeware is like freely it will be available, you can use it. Like we are using this Google Meet or let us say, for example, you cannot have a Cisco WebEx, like Google Meet is free. But if you like, there is some restriction, limitation, no? Like if I want to go more than 100 people using Google Meet, can you go? No. You have to buy. Then either you or the institute has to buy the G Suite. So where you can have 250 or more than that, you have to pay according to your requirement. Even if you have a Gmail, see, if the Gmail is free for 15 GB, if you exceed that, then you have to pay. So it is a freeware. Okay. The other one is a shareware. Shareware is like, let us say, the Adobe Photoshop and some software, MATLAB. Some software, it is not free, but they will give you a trial pack, okay, 30 days trial or 7 days trial. So that's a trial pack. Then they'll say, okay, you try this, then you have to buy. That is called the shareware. Freeware is you can use free, okay, but the source code will not be available for you to modify. You can use it. And if you want to go beyond the limits, then you have to pay for it. Another one is open source code. Thing is totally, mostly it will be free unless otherwise you need some help or customization, okay? So that is where the source code is free, where you can use freely, that is one. So there are different types of softwares available. You can use it according to your things. Always we advocate for open source software. Even Abdul Kalam, ex-president, the former president, advocates for open source software for many reasons, right? And if you see the government mostly, if you see the NIC, National Informatics Center, or any big organization where these softwares are running, it will be only open source software, right? Fine. So when it comes to graphic tools, see here, there are many tools. See, draw.io is a very simple tool where you can create a lot of simple. You might be using different, very sophisticated tools for designing. That is different. For teaching, I'm telling you, okay, I want to put it in my PPT. Like, right? So this draw.io, just to open, put draw.io, like your Google Docs, you can work online, or you can also download it and work offline. You can create beautiful things, and let us say, for example, I'll also just demonstrate it. Might be one thing. So let us say, for example, I'll share my screen. Otherwise, I'll copy it. I'll share my screen. Fine. See, let us say draw.io. It's a very simple one, but I'm not going to teach that, but I'm just going to see. I just put in the Google frame, say draw.io. So many, even in the Word or things, whatever you're using, there also it is available. But here you have lot of icons and other things which you can use it. miscellaneous, see so many things, and you have a different more shapes. You just click on more shapes there. See networking for then maybe business. I will just look at whether civil is there. Okay, mechanical, electrical, everything is there. Production material, fluid, floor plan. Maybe floor plan is available, right? So in a small thing, like this is very very primitive. Like it is not like your design CAD and other things, right? Material design. So you have all these production materials, thread modeling, or electrical. You have many things, floor plan, infographics. So even if you want to do very good presentation, you can have it, create it, and then put it in your PPT. All right, that you can do it. Okay. So a lot of these are all free. Architecture, yeah, architectural, but this is business. And lot of things for the Cisco, like even if I want to have an Azure software or IBM or all those things, all these things are available. So it's a very very simple thing. You can just start working on it, right? Yes, you can drag and drop whatever you wanted. See here, you can drag and drop. So you can work on it. You can do it. So all these things, like you can rotate it, right? You can just do it, fine. And this and one thing is like you might be knowing Blender and other things. Here I can export it easily. I can export it as different types of PNG, JPEG, SVG, PDF, XML. So different things, you know, like that is the beauty of this software. You can one day if you spend on it, you can use it for creating very good pictures, right? Okay, I'm just showing. For example, I'll go back to my presentation. Hope you're like that. See, and this InkSpace and GIMP, that is for the image manipulations and modeling. And for animation tools, you have Blender, where you can have 3D modeling. Okay, for 3D modeling and animation, Blender is an open source software. You have other softwares also, like Autodesk 3DX, 3D Maya, the 3DX, then Maya is there, then Adobe After Effects. Well, so many softwares are available. For audio editing tool, you have Audacity. You can also even as a teacher, I can record my voice using my mobile or even my laptop. Okay, but if you want to do some more on it, okay, you want to mix to like a background music for your audio, for your video, then you want to mix and cut and paste. So you need a editing tool. So for this Audacity, even a simple person can learn. Okay, so there are so many professional as well as very easy, friendly using things are available. And again, video editing tools like Camtasia, Movie Maker, OpenShot, these are the professional where you have the proprietary as well as open source software. See, for example, you're demonstrating a software, Screencastify or Screen-O-Matic. So where you can capture the screen and then make it as a video and give it to your students. Or even the PPT, that is the PowerPoint, you know, there also you have the facilities where you can record your voice, play your video, save it as a video, and then you can share it. So from simple to professional, you can have you according to your interest, according to your requirement, you can have it. Or you can tell your students also to create such content for that. And then authoring tools are like the whole everything put together. I was explaining for image separately, audio separately, for video separately, but everything can be bundled together. Like let us say, for example, Toolkit, then Articulate, then exe is a very wonderful open source software where you can put text material, audio, video, bundle it, and you can have it as a SCOM pack, which you can integrate it with your LMS. It can be in Google for Classroom, or let us say as an HTML file, it will be there, where the students will be having those type of things. And for this, you need some place for deployment, right? So the deployment, when you create as a teacher, when we create all these things, where to deploy? That is only you have to use a LMS or your web portal or website where you can share it with your students, right? So deployment, and then when you're deploying, standards and policy, authoring, everything is important. This support system should be there. So when you develop, you can make it as a package also, or as an individual component. You can create and you can deploy it in the any platform. Two things. One is www, that is World Wide Web, where if you have a website, you can do it. As an institute, you can have it. Or you can have it in your LMS, learning management system, where you can share it between you and your students. Okay. So what you have to do is, see, this is an activity. You can further later do it. So see, we are all teachers. A course, one or two courses will be assigned to us. So when you are taking a course, looking for the course outcome, okay? And for that course outcome, okay, the spelling unit, right? For the course, unit-wise, chapter-wise, or lesson-wise, apart from your teaching, you have to supplement the materials. It can be audio, or it can be video, or it can be open textbooks, or material simulation. So every chapter you should have, or every lesson or unit, however you plan it, right? It should have these items, okay? Apart from your teaching, it should have. So you can create the resources as well as you can create the activities which will help you to go further, right? So definitely you will be facilitating the students to learn, and the learning will be enhanced, okay? So with this, I'll stop my presentation for the first part. So what I'll do is I will take up some questions.
Yeah, yes, madam. So any questions from the participants?
If you are not asking question, I will have a game to play. I will ask questions. No questions? All are waiting for your tea time.
So there is one question, like, what are the tools like Mentimeter?
Mentimeter is one, Poll Everywhere is one, Poll EV, okay? And even, see, if you are using any GoToWebinar or Google Meet, G Suite with Google Meet, then you can have polls, okay? Polly, polls, like Mentimeter, all these things. And you can have quizzes. Maybe I will just put one thing, right? Just now I'm creating it, I'll show it. Okay. Okay, I'll share the screen. See, I go to the Mentimeter. If I want to get the response from the students, or response from the delegates or participants, usually we even do it in our classes. Okay, previously we used to do it in the classes, that we follow it in the online classes also. So here I just said SVC, name any two learner characteristics. Okay, so I put my question here, and then I present. So before that, I will share, I'll copy the link. Okay, I'll copy the link and then go to here. I'll paste the link here, right? So what I'll do is I request all of you to just click the URL which I have shared in the Mentimeter. Okay, so we have learned so many learner characteristics. Okay, so you just enter any two learner characteristics. Just click the menti.com. Okay, menti.com and do that, right? Or you can also enter into www.menti.com and use this code, or you can type this URL. Yes. Somebody said LMS. Okay, fine. The question is name any two learner characteristics. Tools, word. Okay. Relaxed learning, flexible learning. User navigation. So this is a free tool. Okay, you can use it in your classes where you can create a word cloud. Okay, from the answers given, the most repeated one will be at the center, very bold. I can show some things. So when we took a class, when I took class for NIT Tiruchi, around 200 professors, okay, starting from assistant professor to professor head, even the director, NIT Tiruchi, they attended the session and they were actively participating, and a very beautiful cloud was formed with their inputs. So, and not only that, you can also create some quizzes also here. And then open-ended questions here. So many, you can have very good. And you can also download. See, the free version will not give you the things, who has answered what. That will not be available in the free answer, but the total answers, okay? The total response, you can download it as a PDF or as a web, even as an Excel sheet. Okay, if you pay for it, even that lot more analytics will be there. But I'm using the free version itself only. So this is one thing, right? And then, so question everything, yes, knowledge, search, assignment, inner motivation, self-discipline, determined. Okay, this is the learner characteristics, okay, whatever you. Productive learning, curiosity, okay, G class, so very nice. So all are engaged, so you're typing, you're thinking, this is very, very nice. Okay, you can continue, like, let us say, for example, I'll show you like my presentation. I use normally, this time I didn't use it, but normally for all my courses, there are so many pages I have it. Load previous. If you see that it keeps on going from 2019, 18. It'll be a lot of things. There is no limitation for number of classes, but what you can do is see NIT Tiruchi third batch in the NIT Tiruchi 48 voices. One more thing, second batch. May month I conducted one. So the last one is from 1 year. See, this is another one. Which is, so if I want the result, see the result is there, like that. You can see, you can have different things. And even you can have small quizzes, which will, where you can have three types of quizzes in that, in the free form. So any to active learning strategy. Okay, so I will stop my. So Mentimeter is one which you can learn very easily. You can adopt and then learn, then poll everywhere. So these are the different tools. And one more tool in the second session, we'll have quizzes, okay, which you can use it at the end or in between to have the formative assessment, right? So these things, you know, like our students wants to, active learning, and they also like gamification or like it should be motivating them to participate and learn. So for that, we are using these type of tools so that we have to engage them in our teaching learning process, right? And also it is not their results, whatever they are going to give, you can download and you can have it. So with this, I will stop. If there is any more questions, we'll discuss in the next class. Madam, is it the same link or I have to use a different link?
It was a different link, madam. I have shared the link with you.
Okay, okay, okay. Yeah, I thought. Why are you using different links?
Like, since we are recording the session, so we plan to have the different links. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You can have.
Yeah, we can have it, madam. We can have it. There is no issue on that. But for separate session, actually, we have to send it to Anna University. We are reporting them to Anna University. So for that only we have learned.
Okay. Do you have G Suite account or the same account?
We have the institutional G Suite account, madam.
Then you can use the same thing and you need to record. Maybe. Okay. I just, for my curiosity, I was asking, is there any other issues? You know,
No, madam. No specific issues. Okay. Yes.
Thank you. Thank you. I will join in the other class. Let us have a health break. Okay. It is also not good for sitting for hours together. So you have a health break. Then we will. When should we start again, madam?
We can start by 10:45, ma'am. 10:45. So before that, we would like to have a photo session with all the participants because it's mandatory. Okay. So yes, ma'am. So I request all the participants to switch on your video.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, ma'am.
So please join for the session at 10:45.